Hello, this is Michael Tellinger, and I need to take a few minutes to talk to you about the whole banking issue and promissory notes and bills of exchange and questions that arise around that area of information because of my extended struggle with the banks in the Supreme Court of Johannesburg. I have come to learn a great deal about this subject and found a lot of interesting information that you will only find when you actually have to stand and represent yourself in the court against what I guess could be called the highest paid lawyers in the world that represents the banks and the banksters. One of the most important things that I found, and the reason I'm doing this, by the way, is because I get hundreds of emails every week from people around the world asking me about the promissory notes to explain about how to use the promissory notes and so forth. So this is why I'm doing this video, so I can put it on record for once and everyone can look at this and learn from this and be informed, as informed as you can be from what I'm going to share with you, because I'm going to try and share as much as I can with you and show you examples of the promissory notes and how they work, how to deliver them. So firstly, understand that what banks do is completely and utterly criminal. Okay, if you still think that banks are respectable, honorable corporations and companies, then you're still mistaken. Everything that banks do in today's world is basically a criminal activity, and the bank, global banking industry, is the largest organized crime syndicate in the world. They're the ones that are behind creating the laws that they force through our governments, whom they control, creating the laws that are then imposed on society, that control the judiciary, that are upheld by the judges. And often the judges are just very ignorant about what it is that they're actually upholding. So sometimes one can't even blame them. But sometimes, like in my case, it becomes very evident that the judges are paid off by the banks, especially in the case that we had against Standard Bank in South Africa, which became a very high profile case and connected to the Ubuntu Liberation Movement and the Ubuntu Political Party, and it started getting a lot of heat. So sooner or later, the judge was paid off to pass or hand down a fraudulent judgment. The only way that I could protect myself is to learn from that experience. So in other words, I lost the property that I was in court for, and it was auctioned. And then what happens is, once you get a judgment against you, because remember that you can't really win. We can't really win against the banks in the court of law, because as I mentioned, the court and the law is set up to uphold the rights and protect the interests of the banks and the banksters. So you can't win, although there have been a few minor wins in various courts around the world. The major wins will not come until I don't know when. But the reason for that is that if we had a major win against a bank based on the arguments that we pose in the court, that I pose myself, the fact that the bank doesn't have the original contract, and without the original contract there can be no hearing and no court case, a simple fact that should really precede any court procedure from going ahead. And the fact that the bank is no longer the owner of the property, because they sold the contract to a third party, and therefore they can't come after you for money that you supposedly owe them, money that they never lent you, because they remember they create the money out of thin air. But to cut a long story short, one of the very important things that I learned was that banks accept payments in the form of bills of exchange and promissory notes. Now, this didn't come from me. It was information that was spontaneously volunteered by advocate Shem Simon, who represented Standard Bank. This is in my second or third hearing in the Supreme Court of Johannesburg, and he just suddenly blurted out, to our surprise, for some reason that still baffles me, that Standard Bank, which means all banks, accept payment in forms of bills of exchange and promissory notes. And I suddenly went, oh my goodness, this is very important information. Because if I had known this, I would have been able to do something about it long before I got myself into the court and had to stand there, defend myself against the fraudulent and criminal arguments of the banks. So what I then went and did is I spent quite a lot of time with our legal advisor, Raymond Dix, and we looked at the Bills of Exchange Act, the lawful act that guides the financial industry and how money works and how money is created and guides the entire financial sector of our country, of Britain, of the United States and so forth. Every country has got their own equivalent of the Bills of Exchange Act. In South Africa, the Bills of Exchange Act comes from the British Bills of Exchange Act, which I believe is from 1822 or 1882, I think it was. And ours is just a slight bastardization of that British Bills of Exchange Act, suited, slanted towards the needs of the people of South Africa or the needs of the banks that govern and control the people in South Africa. So, we created what we now use as a standard promissory note. And here's a basic example of it. We created a very nice, fancy-looking promissory note. Remember that all the bills in your wallet are actually, let's say, £100 or $100. It's a bill. It's a $100 bill, right? So just like, and it's a promissory note. It's supposed to be a promise to pay. To pay what? To pay $100 on demand, or it's become a very gray area, actually. So what we really, in essence, doing is we're not trying to find a clever way to wangle ourselves out of debt or whatever. We're using the laws and the system that was created, the corrupt and fraudulent system created by the banking fraternity and the banking cartel, to exploit and abuse and enslave humanity. We're using those same laws in our own favor, and somehow it seems to have worked. In my case, and the reason I'm sharing this with you, because I have now paid Standard Bank close to or just over 800,000 Rand with four different promissory notes from about June 2013 until the 12th of December, October 12th, 2014. So over a 1.5 year period, I've paid the bank close to 800,000 Rand in promissory notes that I created. And this is, as I showed you, this is the basic standard promissory note. Now, what's important about it is the information that's written on there. To make it look really fancy, this promissory note is available on the Ubuntu Party website. You can download it and use it for yourself. There's a blank version of this available with text boxes, so you can just click on the text box and fill in your own details and your own information. What you're going to have to change for your respective countries is this little thing here that says, those two lines at the top that say, tender in terms of the Bills of Exchange Act 34 of 1964 as amended up to Bills of Exchange Amendment Act 56 of 2000, and also in terms of the settlement, settlement in terms of the High Court Rule 45-8A. This is in the South African High Court rules. Now, the United States, England, Australia, every country will have their own High Court rules. Now, the High Court rules are the very strict rules that basically control the conduct in the High Court, the way papers must be served, the way they must be filled in, the way the headings must be done, and all the stuff. Now, as a layperson, we don't know the High Court rules, and I had to teach myself all these High Court rules when I represented myself with the aid of a lot of very amazing people. The outcome is that we now know, I've learned all this stuff at great expense, as you now know, and 4 years of blood, sweat and tears and a lot of stress preparing myself for facing these banksters and criminals in the court of South Africa, of Johannesburg. So there's some very basic information on this promissory note. Firstly, it's called a promissory note. Then there's a space that you need to create your own code, the promissory note number, like the number on your bill, on any dollar bill or pound, you'll see there's a number. Okay, well, you make up the number because this is your note, so make up any number that's relevant to you, right? And then you write that number in there. Now, then what you do is you create a little index like this one here. As you can see, there are four entries on this index, and these are the four promissory notes that I've paid. So every promissory note that I pay, I write on this index along with the index number. So I write the date, I write the name of the recipient, and all four recipients here are Standard Bank of South Africa, Standard Bank of South Africa, right? And then the note number, and that note number is that number over there, so that you have a record of what you've paid out and what notes you've created, because now you're creating value. Remember, Banks work with negotiable instruments. Negotiable instruments get their value from our signatures. The moment that I create this, every bill, every invoice, every statement that you sign in the bank, the moment you put your signature on that, you have turned that piece of paper into a negotiable instrument, because your signature creates the liquidity and the value in that piece of paper. So it turns it into a liquid negotiable instrument. And so this is what we're creating here. This promissory note becomes a liquid negotiable instrument with which the bank can trade. And that therein lies the interesting trick that we've encoded in this promissory note, which I'll explain to you now. So there's your promissory note index with all the promissory notes, the number, and then the amount that you made the promissory note for, and then just my own notes that it was the Standard Bank, and then the case number and so forth. This last one that I paid is for the auction shortfall. So in other words, when they auctioned my house, the shortfall on the price of the property was about 500,000 rand, right? Half a million rand. And then the bank still comes after you and make you pay that shortfall for the property that they auctioned. I mean, that's how criminal this thing is. It is insane. It's pure insanity. And only we can get ourselves out of this. So there's your index. Now let me show you the promissory notes. So that's what it looks like printed out on a normal piece of 80 gram bond white paper in a color printer. Very fancy looking promissory note. And then it says here, the promissory note was issued by, was issued at Waterval Boven, Mpumalanga, date 20 November 2014, amount 367,202 rand and 67 cents. And then you write it out like you would on a normal check, and then it says, this certifies that Michael Julius Tellinger, my ID number, hereby promise to pay Standard Bank of South Africa, and then in brackets, the holder, the full amount specified on the note for value received. It's critical that it says that, for value received, so that there is an exchange of some sort that's supposed to take place here. That's also a protection method for yourself. So you can say, if you haven't received any value for this note, then there can be no exchange going on. So, and then it carries on here. Terms and conditions, and this is critical. That's the little terms and conditions, and then date and signature. The date that you create this note, and the signature. Your signature in blue ink. This is critical. I'm going to come back to the blue ink again. Now, the terms and conditions here, I'm going to read out to you, but you can see it on the promissory note. Print out on the Word document that you can download of this, and it says the following. And you're gonna once again have to change this. Just click on the text box and change this, that certain areas that might not apply to you, but it should be generic. And this is what it says: the payment will be made in monthly installments of 500 rand per month on the seventh day of every consecutive month, until the obligation has been fulfilled. Until the obligation has been fulfilled. The obligation stated herein. Okay, we're not saying that we're going to repay or pay the full amount. We use very specific words. Until the obligation has been fulfilled. Because ultimately, no money has ever been loaned. This whole thing was created out of thin air. You were conned and suckered into signing a contract that basically turned you into a debt slave for the rest of your life on home mortgages, most of us, right? Until the obligation has been fulfilled. This, and then it gets even more important. The payment can be obtained by the holder of this note, which is the bank now, because I've given it to the bank, and it's the holder, or if the bank hands the note to someone else, that someone else becomes the holder in due course. These are all legal terms that you learn as you go through this process. So the payment can be obtained by the holder at 17 Zazim Road, Waterval Boven, Mpumalanga. That's this address. So you're making them come to you to fetch the money. There's no obligation that you have to go to them to pay them. You make them come to you to fetch the money. Okay, that's your right. And then it says, I hereby give permission to the holder, the bank who holds this, or if they've sold this note to someone else, which they most likely will, because with your signature on there, you've given them a liquid negotiable instrument. All they have to do is sell it on into the markets, the stock exchange markets and the bond markets in the world. That's what you've done, right? And that's what they trade with bills of exchange, negotiable instruments. You see how this thing gets really, just really wicked, what they've created here. So I hereby give permission to the holder and or the holder in due course of this promissory note to use this note in any way necessary as a negotiable instrument to be financially traded on, means they can trade with this note, this negotiable instrument that you've given them, to be financially traded on, whereas such trade shall terminate the obligation herein. So basically I'm saying that if they sell this note to a third party, that I'm no longer obligated to pay them this amount, because they no longer are the owner of this note and they can no longer come after me. So what have we done? We've given them an option to come and get this money from me on the 7th of the month after they receive this promissory note from me. If they haven't received, if they haven't raised an objection within 7 days, that means they've accepted the note. Even if they raise an objection, they need to raise an objection to say, we don't accept your payment, in which case you tell them, well, this payment is the final settlement and it's delivered, which according to the bills of exchange means that the deal is concluded. Okay, and they need to raise an objection in the court and take you to court to say to the judge that they don't accept your form of payment. They can't just say, we don't accept your payment. They need to start legal procedure against you to say, we don't accept your payment, because this payment is legally sound according to the Bills of Exchange Act. You exercising your right to use promissory note and bills of exchange to pay the bank. This is also very important. Please do not use these kinds of bills of exchange, or promissory notes rather, do not use these promissory notes to pay other people, or to pay shops, or to pay other businesses, because that's not the intention here. They're just normal people like you, caught up in the same trap and the con by the banking fraternity. So only use this, and I have to stress this very, very loudly, only use promissory notes with banks and government institutions, because they're ultimately the instruments of the banks. Okay, if you use it with other people, you're going to get yourself into a lot of trouble. Don't do that. So, if the bank does not come and get this, the money, the 500 rand every month, after the 7th of the month, because it stipulates here, that they must come and get the money from you on the 7th of the month, of every consecutive month. If they don't fetch it on the 7th of the first month, after you've delivered this note to them, you've assumed, and I've assumed, that they have sold the note. And therefore, they're no longer obligated to get the money from me, or allowed to get the money from me. That means I have no longer any obligation to pay any money to them. So, therewith, my obligation has ended. And this, I believe, intelligently structured promissory note based on the laws that govern the bills of exchange has now turned into a liquid negotiable instrument, and you've settled the amount outstanding to the bank. So just to show you how I do it, first of all, I printed out a whole bunch of promissory notes that I printed out on a half a page like this. The reason I do this is because when I fill this in and I sign it, I write underneath in blue ink. First of all, you sign the promissory note over there, you print it out in a printer so it's nice and neat at the top there. And then you sign it with blue ink, and underneath you write here, like you'll see here. This is the copy. This is actually a color photostat of one of the first promissory notes that I paid. And you'll see that I sign here in blue ink underneath. It says here, it says copy there, so it can't be used again as an original promissory note. It says, the original note has been signed in blue ink. So you know there's only one original note. There can't be several copies of it. There can only ever be one note. And the reason, imagine it's like if you take a £100 note or $100 bill from your wallet, there's only one bill. You can't go photocopy it and make copies of it and use that. That's called fraud, right? And so this is, again, there's only one original bill of this, so no one can copy it and benefit from selling copies of this. So that's why you write that. You sign it in blue ink and say the original note has been signed in blue ink. And then you see the space underneath here is critical. I take it to the police station and I sign this in front of the cops so they authenticate that it is my signature on this and put the police stamp on there, the police commissioner of oaths, and the police stamp. So now I've actually validated that this is a real legal document signed by me and turned into a negotiable instrument. Then the important critical delivery comes into play. This is very important. Now you take this promissory note, you make a copy of it, like this one here. There's a copy of it, or one of the copies. It's not exactly the same one, but and then you can see, let's not use the color one because it might be confusing. So, well, let's use the color one because that shows you. So you have an original that you're going to hand to the bank, and you have your photocopy, which is your proof of delivery. And you take, you write a little letter that goes along with it that says, you address it to the lawyers. Now, you have to deliver this to the either the bank's postal and legal document delivery. Don't go to the bank and hand it to the cashier. Okay, you don't deliver promissory notes in that way. That's just not going to work. You have to go to the bank head office and go to the post delivery or the legal document delivery office and deliver this to the person that receives legal documents or the post. They will stamp, they have a stamp that they will stamp proof of delivery for you. Right, and this is critical so that you've got these documents stamped, which proves that you've delivered it and they've accepted your notes in their office and their building. So there you can see, this is the letter. This was to Norton Rose, South Africa, the lawyers that represent Standard Bank, 12th of February 2014. And this was one of the promissory notes. And it says, find enclosed payment and final settlement to your client, Standard Bank, South Africa, regarding bill of costs. Okay, and bill of cost case number, and I put the case number, sincerely, Michael Tellinger. And then you take this with the original promissory note and your copy of the promissory note, and you deliver these three to the bank, postal receiving or the lawyer's legal document delivery office, and you make them stamp all these with proof of delivery. Then you put the attached note that you wrote together with the promissory note, you put it in an envelope, you seal it, and you give it back to the guy that sits behind the desk, and you sign it. I normally sign it to the chief financial officer, because the chief financial officer will probably have a better idea what to do with this promissory note. And that's how I personally delivered these promissory notes, bills of exchange, same thing, promissory notes. And just to show you the ones that I delivered, this is for 75,000 Rand on the 9th of June 2013. There you can see the police stamp and the date, and there you can see the receiving stamp, proof of delivery from the lawyer's office for Standard Bank. Okay, 75,000 Rand, 9th of June 2013. This is 82,000 Rand, 82,000 Rand, also on the same day, 9th of June 2013, for stamped. This was the letter that accompanied it, as I stated already, also stamped, proof of delivery. And then this was this was the third one that I delivered to them. This is a color copy of it, for 279,000 Rand. 279,000. That's a lot of money, people. That's like five times as much as the average South African earns per annum. Okay, and paid and delivered. And then the final promissory note that I delivered, as I showed earlier, on the 20th of November 2014, which is for the shortfall of the auction of my house, and that was for, this is a large one which I didn't deliver, but I can still sign it at any stage, 367,000 Rand for the shortfall on the auction of my house. So all in all, there are four promissory notes, as you can see on the promissory note index. And the total there is close to 800,000 Rand In South Africa, that is an exorbitant amount of money. All these promissory notes have never been contested by the bank or by their lawyers, and as far as I'm concerned, the deal is closed. Any objection right now will have to become a new case, a new action in the court, to present to the judge why they did not accept or do not accept these promissory notes. Unfortunately, more than a year and a half has gone by and they have not raised any objections. So what has happened now is they have now set a precedent. So you can use my case, wherever you are in the world, specifically in South Africa, you can use my case and what you see in this video as the precedent of delivering payment to banks and their lawyers and government organizations by means of a personal promissory note that you create in your home to whatever value or money amount you want to make it for. It can be $1 trillion, it can be $5, it doesn't matter. You make the money out of thin air. You create the value in that promissory note out of thin air, just like banks create money out of thin air. So I hope this has cast some light and knowledge on this so that you don't have any confusion about this. Make sure that you follow this step by step and don't use promissory notes to pay people or businesses or companies, because they're just like you, trapped and enslaved in the system. Go out there and be intelligent about this, and only use it if you really need to, and understand that it's your right and you're now using the legal system and the laws and the bills of exchange in your own favor. Until now, they've been used against us to enslave us and the rest of humanity on this planet. Till next time, have a good day.